this is the story of two families. On the one hand, we have the Rossos, typical all-American family, despite the fact that this is filmed in Canada. On the other hand, we have the Doyle family, bunch of liquored-up dollar store douchebags. The only thing these two families have in common is we're gonna watch them die. Big and Little Joe Rosso are truck drivers. Since everyone needs work, these guys will even deliver for people they don't like.
God, the delivery's 2 hours late, and yet your dumb fuck can't feed my liquor to the dirt!
Think someday someone's gonna punch you in the mouth and put an end to your section.
The late Ned Beatty plays Tiny Doyle, the asshole proprietor of a sleazy strip club. He is also living proof that certain people shouldn't be allowed to reproduce. Tiny has 5 sons, all by different women. Must have been a hell of a Super Bowl party. The Doyle brothers spend their days getting hammered and trying to fuck with the Rossos. If this were a different type of movie, I guess they would be the comic relief. But any chance of injecting humor into the movie goes out the window when they encounter Big Joe's wife and 2 young daughters out on the road. In all seriousness, if you are the least bit squeamish about implied violence against children, I advise you to skip ahead about 40 seconds. Now, the whole idea of an innocent mother and children being terrorized for no reason, coupled with the fact that these kids do a great job of sounding scared, the whole thing just gets a little too real. I mean, it gives me chills. But if the idea was to make the viewer absolutely hate the Doyles, mission accomplished.
The court finds the evidence insufficient to support a manslaughter conviction. However, there is no doubt that Mr. Doyle operated a motor vehicle while under the influence of alcohol. $300 and 1 year in jail. Suspended upon completion of an in-hospital treatment program.
That man killed my wife and kids. Might as well have blown them away with a shotgun. And you fine him $300? He ought to be strung up by his balls.
After an obscene miscarriage of justice and the obligatory barroom brawl, the drunks target Big Joe himself. This is a scene where the stunt coordinators really earned their money. I reckon they only had 1 shot at this, and a little miscalculation would have blown the scene and left the stunt guy buried under tons of iron. Unfortunately, this spells the end for Big Joe, leaving Little Joe Rosso alone in the world, his entire family murdered. And since it's 1987, the only way to follow up this heartbreaking first act is to have a montage. Okay, enough of that. Time for the main event. Let's go crush some redneck ass. That would be a vehicle that can smell fear, mainly because people tend to shit themselves when they see it. Now, it's probably a long shot, but since the plot involves sadistic rednecks, and since Ned Beatty happens to be in the cast, it's got me wondering if the filmmakers here might have been fans of Deliverance. I know this one scene here is vaguely reminiscent.
Squeal like a pig, boy.
Who's afraid of the big bad truck?
The hell I am! I ain't scared of nothing!
The hell is that?
The hell if I know. Holy shit! Fuck off!
The Doyle brothers all seem to enjoy driving Ford trucks. Somehow, Found on Road Dead seems quite appropriate here. Well, this guy's pretty well screwed. I don't know from experience, but I have it on good authority that it is very difficult to run while taking a dump in your pants. There were two monster trucks used in this movie. They were provided by veteran monster truck builder Mike Welch. After filming was completed, Mr. Welch held on to a surviving truck, rebodied it, and named it Super Pete. Ironically enough, Super Pete spent the next decade entertaining thousands of drunk rednecks. Four down, two to go. So like, did you hear the one about the monster truck that walked into a bar? Well, to wrap it up, I gotta say that as far as low-budget B-movies go, this was one hell of an effort. A lot of great action here, and the plot can be powerfully emotional at times without devolving into outright cheesiness. It's also an interesting look at a bygone era of filmmaking where revenge movies did not all feature Liam Neeson playing the same motherfucker over and over again. No disrespect to Mr. Neeson, though. I know he could kick my ass in a fight.
And another one gone, and another one gone, another one bites the dust, hey, hey, gonna get to do, another one bites the dust.